Well, let me go straight to what I'm going to talk about, so you don't have to wait too long for your another course. That's the first announcement. Second, I will, of course, as usually, leave the space for your questions and even possibly my answers in cases I know them at the end of my speech. But if you feel like asking during the during my speech, please just raise your hand. Go ahead. As you probably may have heard from me, time to time, I started my lecturing career in U.S. university teaching. Teaching undergraduate students, including football players, the basic economic courses, and hardly any question can surprise me consequently. So let me start with just what I'm going to talk about. It's a very sort of traditional presentation. I will talk about boring recent macroeconomic developments. Then I will have even a more boring part in all consequences about our interventions, which sort of solves whatever happens for the rest of this year in monetary policy realm. And then I will end up with forecasts that will turn out wrong in future, but you will never notice because we will issue another one in a quarter of year. So to start with, we are sort of bottoming out of the second part of WV recession. The second part was not that steep one, or the second bottom part was not that steep one as the first one, but it was much longer. And I believe we all feel sort of relieved that the economy month to month starts growing, and it seems there are a lot of hopeful signs for future. Some of the hopeful signs are, of course, related with industrial output. It starts growing quite, I would say, more robustly than before. And let me just remind you, we are still an industrial-based country. We are more industry-based country than 10 or 15 years back in past, and that's. Makes us with some other new EU members sort of exceptional in current world of increasing weight of services and decreasing weight of production. Even our consumers, if we put, I must say, strong warning, if we put retail sales, car sale indicator in, seem to start spending. What is important, November, of course, might have been related with our action that weakened the exchange rate. But despite all their warnings that people will exhaust their willingness to shop, even December look better than last year. And that's quite a hopeful sign. Talking about weakening, well, we weakened the exchange rate on a relatively unhappy day of 7th of November. I mean, historical connotation, of course, of this day, which somehow happened to coincide with our regular monetary policy meeting. And then the currency slightly weakened itself. And as we all know, it stays around 27.50. Without our influence at all. Inflation, well, inflation was why we did it. There were some who questioned whether our models forecast correctly the fall of inflation in January. I believe this week we've learned that in this way our models were forecasting quite nicely. Without the intervention, we would probably be seeing now inflation falling down to -1 in a rather obvious steady way, and that's why we did it. So inflation now is still anyway very close to zero, and monetary policy inflation is that lower because we sort of exhausted all VAT taxes influence that make different our headline inflation and monetary policy relevant one. As to its structure, well, it's the administrative prices are sort of concealing the fact that there are other, first that they are market influenced based prices, and second there are other prices that are falling steadily, including adjusted inflation, which sort of captures the core inflation phenomena within the economy. On the other hand, and quite unhappy for poorer bracket consumers, the food prices are increasing due to two main factors. First, China starts consuming more and more milk, which is a global phenomenon. And second, we had actually, which you may not have heard about, but last year we had the worst potato harvest from 1920s. So that's driving quite a bit of food prices up. All right, as to Forex intervention, what we did, what preceded the intervention, we've been essentially at zero for more than a year, from November 2012. When we reached the zero, we announced that if there would be a strong need to ease monetary conditions, we do this with weakening exchange rate. Then we did a lot of small steps. Probably the most notable was when we suspended sale of return on forex reserves, because we never intended our forex reserves to increase that much. And then we started intervening verbally. I believe at the fall, last year fall, the effectiveness of our verbal intervention was quite obviously exhausted, and markets started speculating that we would never move. At the same time, the new forecast showed that we need to weaken the monetary policy condition much more than we previously thought. So that was an obvious thing to do to start moving, and we did what we did, which means okay, I can skip this slide, which is good. Just let me tell you, okay, or I'll go more to reasons, all right. We saw, of course, other things. We saw falling inflation in euro area. We saw output gap sort of returning even to even worse levels than in the first part of recession. And lowest wage growth in years. We saw even service prices decreasing, which was also quite unexpected given what one expect from converging new economy within the Europe. Service prices should be almost always in positive. So these were all sort of main reasons why we felt we need to move. So we decided to weaken exchange rate around a level of 27 krons per euro, which coincidentally was what we thought is the level that should move the inflation to 2%, which is our target, in 2 years of 2014-2015. So we sort of wanted to base it on a target. Honestly, we didn't do too much of transactions or too long. This was a few days when we did it, then the currency settled itself slightly below 27, at 27, around 27.50, when, as you know, well, it's staying so far. In terms of what we expect, a part of reaching the inflation target, it's a weakening of monetary policy condition. Therefore, it helps the economy to grow, and 1% growth is related approximately 35,000 jobs. Being saved or created or not destroyed, depending on external conditions. Simply the difference. All right. And we said we will end up, as soon as we see strong enough inflationary pressures. We also never committed to 27 fully, which is, by the way, more or less the lecture we learned from those who started sooner than us. We discussed this sort of operation with, among others, Swiss National Bank that intervened with Israelis and with Chile and few others. So we decided that we will be a little bit more flexible. So what we are essentially saying is we may change the target level, but only if there is a dramatic change, and this sort of means we do not consider this to be an interest rate which is we move. We understand this is much more blunt tool, and we do not want to move it too often. And that's it. What we see now, well, we forecast a pretty nice upturn this year. Actually, we forecast the GDP above 2%. As to inflation, we expect it to be at the end of the year around the target, around 2%, then to move up close to 3%, so close to upper bound of our tolerance band, and then to start declining back to 2% at the end of next year. In terms of interest rate, we do not expect them to be moved from zero till the end of this year. And well, it's not here, but we so far are quite sure that this policy will stay with us at least at the end of this year. Well, so let me sum it up. We are gradually emerging from recession. We are in sort of recovery phase after quite a long recession that was based on essentially lack of demand through all these years. We saw disinflationary pressures quite strengthening around the end of last year, so we acted to prevent a longer period of deflation in this economy. And as it was not possible to do it with interest rate, we had to do it with exchange rate. So that's about the end of it. I have one thing that is popping up sort of irregularly here. You know this picture of mine from previous sessions. You know that there is an email around. And again, actually, there is a phone number. That's phone number to Slovakia. Last year, I somehow managed to erase for the Slovak element, being it 1 after 4-2. But this time, the Slovak element returned back, and we all know that we lived a long time together with Slovakia in one state, and it's probably some Freudian reflection of it in my presentation. So anyway, if you have any smart question after I leave this hall and your lovely company here, please send me an email and don't call our phone line, and that's the best way how to do it. When I was a vice governor, I always said I will end all your questions being sent to me by email, but once I have risen a little bit higher, I can assure you I will let somebody to answer all your questions. And whoever has a question now, please address it.